Welcome, everyone, to this month's Behind the Breakthroughs program, Translating Science into New Treatments for Pancreatic Cancer. My name is Hillary Rapucci, and I'm a senior director in Dana-Farber's Office of Philanthropy. Today's webinar could not come at a more appropriate time, as November is Pancreatic Cancer Awareness Month. And the presenters joining us today are laser-focused on advancing our understanding of pancreatic cancer and strategically developing the most innovative methods to prevent, detect, and treat this difficult disease. We want this program to be interactive, so I welcome you all to please write in the chat where are you tuning in from to kick us off. In the meantime, I'd like to share a few housekeeping notes. All attendees are on mute and your cameras are turned off to ensure everyone can adequately hear the program. Should you have questions or comments throughout this evening's program, we encourage you to use the chat icon on the bottom of your screen. We'll have time to address these questions after we hear from our speakers. And as a reminder, we won't be able to address any personal health concerns today, but we do encourage you to direct specific questions to your doctor. Before we hear from the director of the Hale Family Center for Pancreatic Cancer Research, Dr. Brian Wolpin, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce a special video message from Dana-Farber trustee, Judy Hale. Judy and her family have become synonymous with Dana-Farber's focused efforts to understand, prevent, and treat pancreatic cancer. And their visionary support has made Dana-Farber a worldwide leader and a pioneer in this field. Judy's vision and foresight also led us to establish our very first Tiger Team focused on pancreatic cancer, which is now the model for how we approach so many of the most challenging cancers. Please join me in welcoming Judy.
With your understanding, I prefer to read my remarks rather than speak extemporaneously. Hi, I am Judy Hale, and I'm delighted to welcome all of you to this session of learning about pancreatic cancer. Interest in this session of learning about pancreatic cancer is not a club that I would choose to be a member of, and probably many of you would say the same. But the hand that I was dealt commands that I listen, learn, and support the work going on here at Dana-Farber regarding pancreatic cancer. Perhaps the same is true for you. Almost 15 years ago, my husband died of this dreaded disease. For 3 or 4 years, my life was misery. But then I realized that the only way to fight back was to support those who are studying and researching this horrible disease. And so I started funding research at Dana, and shortly thereafter, members of my family joined in this effort as well. Today, the researchers at the Hale Family Center for Pancreatic Cancer are considered among the best and the brightest in the United States. There is a group of other best and brightest from other leading USA hospitals for cancer research who have joined together to study and fight pancreatic cancer. I'm proud to say that Dana-Farber has been selected to be the leader of this group. I am delighted that some of our researchers are here with us tonight and can tell you about progress made and progress planned. Their Hale challenge is to find a way to discover cancer of the pancreas soon enough so that the patient can be treated and live on. I'm pleased to introduce Dr. Brian Wolpin, who will lead the session this evening. Dr. Wolpin, MD, MPH, is a medical oncologist and is director of the Gastrointestinal Cancer Center at Dana-Farber. He's the Robert T. and Judith B. Hale Chair in Pancreatic Cancer, director of the Hale Family Center for Pancreatic Cancer Research, and director of the DFCI Lustgarten Foundation Pancreatic Cancer Laboratory at Dana-Farber. He is also professor of medicine at Harvard Medical School. As well, he sees patients in the gastrointestinal cancer clinic and runs a multidisciplinary research laboratory focused on early detection and novel treatments for pancreatic cancer. I introduce Dr. Wolpin, Dr. Extraordinaire.
Hi, everyone. I really do have to say how thrilled I am to have you join us for this session tonight. And of course, the lovely remarks and introductions from Judy. We really have an incredible debt of gratitude to Judy, Rob, Karen Hale, and also to many of you in the audience who have helped us to establish the Hale Center, which, as Judy said, really has become one of the leading centers for pancreatic cancer research in the country and in the world. So we're really very excited to share with you today some of the work that we have been doing to try to change how we treat and manage this disease. Let me see. There we are. All right, I'm going to share my screen to show you slides on some of the work that we've been doing. So we thought quite a bit about what we wanted to talk about this evening. There are just so many things going on in the research setting and in the clinic in pancreatic cancer, in particular at the Hale Center. So what we decided to do is really focus tonight on a description of how do you go from science happening in the laboratory, the work that we're doing in the lab, how do you go from that to changing the care of patients? And so really what we would entitle this is the bench to bedside transition. How do you take laboratory science and bring it to patients? And in particular, we're going to talk about new therapies. As Judy mentioned, we also have a very large effort in early detection. We'll have to come back and do this again because there's only so many things we can cover in one session. We decided tonight, though, to really focus on therapy and how we're trying to bring new therapies to patients. So these are the participants in addition to myself. Andy Aguirre, who's a medical oncologist here at Dana-Farber and runs a large research laboratory focused on pancreatic cancer. Stephanie Dugan, who's a research scientist here at Dana-Farber and focuses in particular on the immune system. Turns out Stephanie had a last minute conflict, so isn't going to be able to join us, but we will showcase some of her work and discuss how that work has led to new clinical trials in patients. And then Kim Perez, who's really one of our oncologists extraordinaire, who really cares for a lot of patients with pancreas cancer in the clinic and is really an expert about how we bring science to the clinic for clinical trials. And she's gonna talk about that. So here's an outline so we know where we're headed in terms of our discussion this evening. So to start with, we'll do a brief overview, which I will do, a short overview of pancreatic cancer, the disease. I think many of you may be familiar with this, but just to highlight some of the problems we have in this disease and what we need to do to fix those problems. We'll also give you a short overview of the Hale Center, because you'll hear us talk about that quite a lot. And it really is the way we bring together all of our scientists, clinicians, investigators to jointly fight back against this disease. And we want to describe to you how that looks. Then we'll talk about two projects. One is around how you modify the cell state of tumor cells to exploit that for treatment. And we're going to show you how work then led to a clinical trial. And another is around how you target KRAS, which is an important oncogene in pancreas cancer. And then we'll have a little bit of time at the end for a panel discussion and answer your questions. And again, as Hillary noted, would encourage you along the way to put your questions and comments into the chat box, which we will then look at when we get to the discussion of the panel. All right, so this is really a one slide overview of this disease to pancreatic cancer. Obviously we could spend a lot longer, but really to try to bring us up to speed together on the difficulties we face in this disease. So to start with, I just want to point your attention to the top row here of bars with the different colors. So what these are the stage of disease, the stage meaning the extent of the disease at the time that it presents. And what you can see in the green, these are the people who present with what's called localized disease or early stage disease. These are the people who can have surgery in many instances, and these are the individuals who we have the best chance to be able to cure. That's really what the percentages here are, a proxy for the ability to cure patients with this stage of disease. What you very quickly notice, though, and Judy mentioned this in her remarks, is that this number, the 20%, means that there's really a relatively small number of individuals who present with disease that can be cured and is found early. And that's one of our major problems in this disease, is that it tends to present late, and that makes it very hard to get rid of for our patients. And part of the goal, one major goal of the Hale Center, is to move this to the left and make this number larger, the number of individuals we find the disease early. A second big issue, you see the yellow and the blue bars, those are locally advanced and metastatic disease. Those are cancers we very rarely can cure. That's a big number, right? It's obviously the inverse of the 20%, meaning 80%. And it's a very aggressive disease, which again, I know a number of you in the audience have experience with. This disease tends to grow very fast. It's not a slow growing kind of cancer. And many patients can pass away even less than a year from the time that they were diagnosed. And so really what it calls out for is we not only need to move the disease and find it earlier, we need to find new therapies that allow us to treat it better. And these are some of the treatments we have, including chemotherapy and some what are called precision therapies, where we use the characteristics and sequencing information of the tumor to try to find new therapies. But there is a big gap here still, where we really need to understand the biology of the cancer and treat it better. And that's another major, major effort in the Hale Center. And it's really what we're going to focus on tonight. So I wanted to just, again, orient you to what the Hale Center is and means, because it really is the organizing principle for how we do research and clinical care for pancreatic cancer at Dana-Farber. So this is the mission of the Hale Center, which is the Pancreatic Cancer Center. What you can see is it's really focused on innovation and accelerating our innovation and our progress to rapidly translate scientific discoveries to the clinic and to make sure we're thinking not only of treatment, but also detection. How do we find this disease early? And I hope you can tell as it talks about accelerate and rapid and progress that we understand the urgency of this, that we, many of us in the Hale Center, are also taking care of patients in clinic. And we know we need this progress now, right? It's not something we want to see 10 years from now. It's something we want to do now. And so there really has been a big emphasis on doing things together and doing it as quickly as we can to impact care in the clinic. So this is the Hale Center team. This slide over the past 5 years has gotten bigger and bigger in terms of the number of pictures. You'll see as we give our talk, we like pictures of faces of people, because it's people who do science and it's people who then are going to help patients. And you should see who these people are, right, that are behind all this work. I can't go through them all, obviously, but this is the Hale Center team. Each of the faces here under investigators are either scientists or clinicians working together to fight this disease. And they all have their own groups of people they work with. So when you add all this together, it's, you know, hundreds of people in aggregate. But we really have made a huge effort in the Hale Center to bring together people from different backgrounds, different specialties, to all work together. And teamwork is really what we are focused on in the Hale Center. So a few examples. So Sarah Burlage is a chemist. So she's working on designing new chemical matter that we can use to treat the disease. Wilfried Pastor just joined the Hale Center this year as a new scientist. He's focused on the immune system. How do we harness the immune system to attack pancreas cancer? Two very established and senior investigators, Bill Hahn and Kevin Higgis, are focused on KRAS and as part of their work and how we attack KRAS, which is something Andy's going to talk about in the talk tonight. Francisca Mikor is a mathematician. So how do we bring mathematical models to understand how we treat this disease better? So really, it's bringing together people from all kinds of specialties all across the institute to fight together, right, to do this together. And then we really have a wonderful staff. These are mostly scientists who work for the Hale Center and facilitate all of the science that we're doing between the labs, right? There needs to be a big organizational infrastructure if you're going to have 15 to 20 different PIs all working together. And they really do a wonderful job with that. And then one last piece I wanted to say about the Hale Center. So we fund individual projects within the individual PI's labs. They work together on those projects, but they still originate generally from one or two labs. But we also come together as a group and do team work, meaning where we have many PIs working together to solve a particular problem. We call this our priority research areas. And there are four of them, which I wanted to highlight. Again, mostly because there's really only so much we can talk about today. And I do want you to really understand the scope of the work, which is really tremendous in the center. So, and you can see again, faces, these are sort of the lead PIs of these team-based projects, although there's a whole group of people who are working together with them. But what you can see here, we have these sort of in four bins, these four team project or priority research area bins. One is, how do you understand those initial lesions that form cancer, right? What are those originating events? Because if we can understand very early how this cancer develops, we can move to the next box, which is allowing us to either prevent it altogether, that's the best kind of cancer, the one you prevented, or detect it very early when we have a chance to cure it, right? So understand the initiating events that lead to cancer, and then understand how you leverage that understanding for early detection and prevention. But if you're going to find it early, you need to be able to treat it effectively. And so we have a priority research area team working on early tumors. What's the biology when the cancer is early? And how do you make sure you treat it most effectively? And then we have a large research effort around this idea, again, of precision medicine. Understand the biology of the tumor, treat each person differently, dependent upon their specific tumor. Don't try to treat everyone the same. A huge effort in that space. All right. So I gave you an overview of some of the problems in pancreatic cancer we're trying to address, an overview of the Hale Center. Again, we'll come back and hopefully have more opportunities to talk with everyone about other work in the center, including on early detection too. And then now I'll transition and I'm going to turn it over to Andy Aguirre. Again, one of our outstanding medical oncologists and scientists. And he's going to tell you about a project that led to new findings, really state-of-the-art work that was understanding how tumor cells change under selective pressures, sometimes called the tumor cell state. And again, here's Andy on the left, who's now going to take it from here. So Andy, I'll pass it to you.
Great. Well, thanks a lot, Brian. And thank you all for attending this webinar tonight and listening. And it's a pleasure to be here. As Brian mentioned, I'm a medical oncologist and run a research lab focused on pancreatic cancer in the Hale Center. And what I'm going to tell you tonight about is a story of how we studied human pancreatic cancer, allied with our patients to study their disease in the laboratory, identified an interesting signaling pathway that could be blocked. And then Kim's going to later tell you about how those observations really helped lead to a clinical trial within the Hale Center and elsewhere. So as many of you know, you can study pancreatic cancer in many different ways. We study pancreatic cancer in cell lines in the lab or using what are called organoid models or derived from patients. We study pancreatic cancer in mice and make mouse models of pancreatic cancer. But really what we consider our greatest resources and allies in our research at Dana-Farber are our patients. And so in the Hale Center, we've really made a concerted effort over the last decade to really understand human pancreatic cancer, to work with patients who so generously participate in our research programs, and to learn from every biopsy from every patient that comes through our doors. And so what I'm going to tell you about today is an effort called single cell RNA sequencing. And it was really led by the group at the bottom left of the screen, including Sri Raghavan, who's a new faculty member at Dana-Farber, just started his lab. Pete Winter and Andrew Navia, who are postdoctoral scientists at Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and then Hannah Williams, who's a postdoc in our groups at Dana-Farber as well. And so you can see a very multidisciplinary collaboration between scientists and biologists at MIT and Dana-Farber to develop an approach where we can biopsy a patient, take that biopsy, separate it into its constituent cells. So each biopsy is made up of many thousands of cells, separate those out and look at each cell individually in the biopsy. And we can also grow what are called organoid cultures from that biopsy so that we can make a living tumor model and study that patient's tumor serially through many days and many weeks in culture in the laboratory. So next slide, please, Brian. And so what is single cell RNA sequencing? So we often make the analogy that single cell RNA sequencing is like looking at each individual piece of fruit in the smoothie. How we've studied cancer for years and decades is by taking a piece of tumor and grinding it up and looking at what the DNA or the RNA or the protein look like in aggregate, sort of an average of all different possible cell types. Well, you can see that you lose resolution in that approach. What is each strawberry or raspberry or kiwi? What does that taste like? And what does that look like? So you can think of single cell RNA sequencing as taking a really high resolution look at all the different parts of a tumor, all the different cells, so that we can understand exactly what's making up those tumors and what's in that biopsy and how that's contributing to the behavior of that particular tumor. So next slide, please. So we performed single cell RNA sequencing on about 23 different biopsies, each biopsy taken from a different patient with pancreatic cancer. The patients consent to these research protocols and work with us and donate their tissue to these programs. And then we study what the individual tumor cells and all the different cells look like in that biopsy. And so you can see on the left, a fairly complicated looking graph that has a simple message. You can see each patient is represented by a pie chart, and that pie chart has different colors in it. Each of those different colors represents a different type of tumor cell or a different tumor cell state. And you can see that there are tumor cells called basal cells or classical cells, or these co-expressing tumor cells that are somewhere in the middle. And so one major observation is that every patient's biopsy is actually a mixture of these different tumor cell states or different types of cells. And so if we look at, we can see that in the RNA level. And on the right panel, we used an approach called multiplexed immunofluorescence that was developed by Dr. Wolpin and his team at Dana-Farber. And we can see not only at the RNA level, but at the protein level. So DNA makes RNA, which makes protein. So we can see overlap and different heterogeneous expression patterns of these cell types. So every pancreatic cancer is actually a mixture of different cell states. And why is this important? Well, these tumor cell states have different behaviors. And so certain types of cells, even in pancreatic cancer, where we consider all tumors as bad, certain cell types in pancreatic cancer are particularly bad and have particularly poor behavior. So if we can identify these, then we can figure out what to do about them. So next slide, please, Brett. And one thing that we found in these single cell RNA sequencing studies, we're able to look at not only the tumor cells, but all the other surrounding cells. The tumor cells in a tumor, the malignant cells, the cancer cells, they're actually surrounded by all different types of cells, including fibroblasts and immune cells. And those cells signal back and forth to each other. And so what we found is that TGF-beta, a growth factor, is associated with this particularly poorly prognostic state, the basal-like state. And so we went on to study this, and this is work done by Sri Raghavan. If you go to the next slide, please, and understood that if we model that basal-like state in the lab and look at cells that look more classical, so the more well-behaved state versus the basal-like or very poorly differentiated, poorly behaving state, they actually have differences in drug sensitivity. And so if we can understand those differences in drug sensitivity, then we can understand how to target those better. And so this really started us thinking about these different tumor cell states and getting at the idea if we can potentially target that basal-like state, either eliminate that or push it back towards the more well-behaved state, we may be able to create some interesting therapeutic opportunities. Next slide, please. So now I'm going to pass it back to Brian, who's going to introduce Kim, who's going to tell us a little bit more about how we could use that concept therapeutically.
Excellent. Thank you, Andy. So again, to summarize what Andy is describing, this really was a new finding in pancreas cancer, right? Really brought about by the new technologies that were available to us and a long-running collaboration with our engineering colleagues at MIT. But it really, as Andy said, allowed us to look at every individual cell in a tumor and start to really understand the heterogeneity that's there And through that work, which was a multi-year effort, really start to understand new therapeutic opportunities. So it turns out while that work was being done, Stephanie Dugan in her lab and a group of trainees and postdocs in her group were actually taking a different approach to try to understand this. And Kim is going to provide you an overview of the work that Stephanie was doing in her lab, which it turned out dovetailed extremely well with the work Andy just described and led us then to a clinical trial. So I'm going to turn this now to Kim to take us through this part.
Thank you, Brian, and thank you everybody for joining us this evening. I'm Kim Perez. I'm a medical oncologist here at Dana-Farber. I see patients here and in my spare time also work with these two wonderful physicians to develop clinical trials based on the work from their lab. So I have big shoes to fill tonight. My colleague, Stephanie Dugan, unfortunately is not able to join us, but I think it fits that I start with her story because it leads to the clinical trial that I have been working with her to develop and hoping to open within the next month or so. So the question that we all have as scientists is why do cancers grow? How do they communicate with one another? How do we cut off that signaling that may be encouraging an environment for cancer growth? And so from an immune system standpoint, because that is Stephanie's background, that is what immunologists have described, not just in the cancer environment, but it's just in the body. So there are what are called cytokines, which are messengers between cells, can release them and send messages to other parts of the cell to communicate parlay different messages. And then some cells can secrete these same cytokines or messages to other cells, and cells around will respond. So appropriately, scientists like Stephanie determined that these are ideal targets. Why aren't we looking at these as targets for trying to cut off that message from one cell to another or one cell to itself in anticipation that that was having an impact on cancer, cancer growth. Next slide. And so this beautiful picture is just to depict the multiple different cytokines that have been identified as participating or part of possible communication in the cancer cell process or development. And so again, just to show you how complex a network a tumor can be and how all these overlapping signaling pathways are great targets to develop novel therapies to try to cut off that crosstalk. Next slide. And that's exactly what Stephanie and her colleagues did in her lab. So this is back to the TGF-beta, which was the growth factor that Andy had mentioned in his slides, is one of those cytokines, one of those messengers that's being sent from one cell to another. And what was determined from her work and with her colleagues in her lab was that since we identified that was one of the cytokines or messages being parlayed to other cells and participating in growth, if we block that that signal, were we going to help or enable chemotherapy, which is what I give in the clinic to patients with pancreatic cancer? Could we make that work better? And so you can see here on the left side of your slide with this the different pictures. So you have the 3x2 blocks here of blue images, where if you look to the right of it, you have FOLFIRINOX and gemcitabine and nab-paclitaxel. Those are two of our standard chemotherapy regimens used to treat pancreatic cancer. And what her work has demonstrated is if you block the TGF-beta, you can actually promote tumor cell death when given in combination with either gemcitabine, nab-paclitaxel, or FOLFIRINOX. And that's what the green colors are depicting in this image. So you can see that without the blockade, not much is happening, but with the blockade, you have an increase in tumor cell death. And the graph to the right also is depicting similar findings in that you can see an increase. So the green, the darker green bar and the lighter purple bar to the far right, those both represent an increase in cancer cell death when TGF-beta blockade and chemotherapy are combined. And this also depicts the what was found in her mouse models, which was that the tumor, the pancreatic tumors also were reduced in size significantly with this combination of chemotherapy and TGF-beta blockade. So with that, with those encouraging results, what was also determined was that the TGF-beta also, as Andy was mentioning, had an influence on this change in state. So what we had started our talk about was that our colleagues here have identified this classical state and basal-like state of the pancreatic tumor cells. And we have determined that the classical state pancreas cells seem to be more sensitive to chemotherapy. And so what we're trying to do in our challenges is to try to move the more basal-like state cancer cells to this classical state to make them more sensitive. And so this work that Stephanie's lab has demonstrated is that that impact of the TGF-beta blockade and chemotherapy is moving cells to this classical state and making cells more sensitive to chemotherapy. So when all this data was presented, as we meet pretty regularly just because we're all very anxious to get new drugs out to patients. We were all very excited to see these results. And so we amassed this really great group of individuals to help move this preclinical work to the clinic. And so you can see many of my colleagues here are involved and they span from within Dana-Farber, as well as colleagues at MD Anderson and at Novartis. And what all our putting our heads together, what we came up with was this clinical trial where we're gonna combine a TGF-beta blocking drug with FOLFIRINOX. Again, FOLFIRINOX being one of the standard chemotherapy agents combinations that we give to patients with pancreatic cancer. And in the study that we've developed and we're planning to open, it's a phase two, which is just a type of clinical trial, which means we know that there's safety there to doing the combination, but we wanna just know how much of an effect it's going to have on the pancreatic cancer. And it's gonna be a combination, and the patients that we're looking to treat are patients that have been newly diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. And when we look at their scans, we see that their cancer is limited still to the pancreas. So we consider them resectable, or another term that we use is borderline resectable, meaning they've grown just a little bit to involve some important structures around, but there's not enough involvement there that we think that surgery will still be part of their plan. So the idea is to try to learn from the biopsy, the diagnostic biopsy, put these patients on this trial with the combination, and then get them to surgery and learn more about their tumors once the tumor has been removed. And our goal obviously is not only to learn, but we're hoping that after we're able to activate this trial and treat patients on this trial, that we're gonna see an increase in cure rates for patients who have surgery after receiving this treatment. To Brian.
Okay. All right. So to again summarize, really two different groups within the Hale Center talking to each other regularly, as Kim noted, but took very different angles to study this cancer. One was really focused on single cell RNA sequencing. That's the work Andy described. Stephanie was really started out looking at the immune system and some of those signals, as Kim described, between different cell types in the immune system. But it converged on the same thing, that this molecule, TGF-beta, seems to be dictating communication between cell types and seems to help govern sensitivity of these tumors to treatment. And in the lab now, in many different ways, in culture, organoids, mouse models, seems to be effective in better treating this disease. So that then becomes, as we do that together, the science we use to do the clinical trial, which I would say, as Kim noted, we brought our friends at MD Anderson to do with us because we work with them quite a lot. And we now have asked friends at another institution, NYU, to join us. We worked with colleagues at Novartis who make the compound that blocks TGF-beta. And really, we try as rapidly as we can to move these lines of science into the clinic to help patients, which is what the trial that Kim is leading is now set to do when it opens in about the next month or 6 weeks or so. All right, so we wanted to also, though, talk because there really is a sea change coming, we think, in pancreas cancer treatment down the road related to KRAS, which is an oncogene that's very common in pancreatic cancer. And Andy really is a world expert in this gene and protein. And we have a huge effort, which we've had for multiple years now, in the Hale Center to study KRAS. So we wanted to make sure we also talked about this and gave you a sense of some of the work going on in this space. And so Andy's going to take the next few slides and describe that.
Great. Thanks, Brian. So many of you who've learned about pancreatic cancer may have heard of the gene KRAS. And it really is, as Brian was suggesting, the elephant in the room in terms of drivers of this deadly disease. But it's also a very challenging therapeutic target. It's mutated in over 90% of pancreatic cancers. And what we've learned through work in our center and elsewhere is that even when KRAS isn't mutated, in many of that 10% of patients, it's also activated and still a driver in this disease. So if there's one target that we've known about for decades that we should be developing drugs against in pancreatic cancer, it's KRAS. But it's been a very challenging target to develop small molecules that bind to that drug and inactivate that drug. And it's been one of the most difficult targets in all of oncology drug development. But there have been some really important recent advances that have allowed us to develop small molecules that bind to the protein and inactivate it. And there are some really exciting new clinical trials that are coming down the pike in, for pancreatic cancer patients. We want to tell you a little bit about those today. Next slide, please. So we've been able to work with many different pharmaceutical companies to study these drugs. These drugs have been developed and they bind different forms of RAS, different types of mutations of RAS, and many different groups at Dana-Farber and across the country now are studying these small molecule inhibitors of the RAS protein, including my own group, Brian Wolpin's group, Stephanie Dugan's lab, Joe Moncius's lab at Dana-Farber. It's really a Hale Center-wide effort to understand these compounds and figure out how we can utilize them in patients. And so on the left in this slide, you see patient-derived organoid models from our patients at Dana-Farber. So each of those lines represents the drug sensitivity testing of a KRAS inhibitor in what's called an organoid model derived from a pancreatic cancer patient. So each of those numbers and each of those colored lines represents a living tumor model that's grown in the lab that was derived from a biopsy from one of our patients. And we study those. They're all de-identified and not linked to the patient in the laboratory, but we study how those models respond to these new inhibitors and these new therapies. And in doing so, we can understand, and if you look at that plot on the left, some of those lines go very low to the bottom. If you look at the percentage of viability, the percentage of cells surviving after treatment with a drug at increasing doses, some of those lines go to the bottom, some of them stay higher up at the top. So there's variation in responses of these models. And in learning about those variable responses, we understand what might be biomarkers of response and resistance so that we can put patients who are most likely to respond onto the drugs that are most likely to benefit them. And we've also studied these inhibitors in the lab in mouse models. And on the right are a plot that's really a collaboration with Stephanie Dugan's lab and Joe Moncius' lab and in our Hale Center animal models facility, where we are able to take mice that are engineered to develop pancreatic cancers, and we're able to treat those mice with these drugs, give those mice the therapies just as we would a human being, but give them to them over time. And so you can see the blue lines are lines that are treated with mice that are treated with one of these inhibitors. And you can see over many days, hundreds of days in some cases, the tumors shrink in size and stay small in size or non-existent in the models over many, many days. Whereas the red lines are those that are treated with a control compound or a vehicle, that no drug, those progress rapidly and unfortunately kill the mice over time. So we've identified that these therapies actually have efficacy in patient-derived models and in these mouse models. And so we're extremely excited about them. Next slide, please. And so these therapies have actually been tested in patients in small numbers. In fact, there's one very small clinical trial of an inhibitor of a particular rare form of KRAS, a codon G12C mutation. So it's a particularly rare allele and rare mutation in pancreatic cancer. 10 patients were treated with pancreatic cancer who had this mutation. Of those patients that were treated, 5 of those patients, or 50% of those patients, had a response. All of those patients achieved some sort of benefit, either stable disease where the disease wasn't progressing, or had a response. Now, these are small numbers. They need to be validated over larger studies, but they are reason for, you know, extreme optimism about the potential of these drugs in patients. But we know that many of these patients, even if they respond, they're going to develop what's called resistance, or the tumors are going to come back. So we've also made a lot of effort to study those tumors that relapse and have resistance mutations, and to figure out what do we treat the patient with next, or what do we give in combination with a RAS inhibitor that would prevent the relapse altogether. Next slide, please. And so we've developed a multidisciplinary team at the Hale Center. And as Judy suggested at the beginning, really expands beyond the Hale Center and collaborates with many different institutions across the country and across the world to both develop new therapeutic strategies, working with companies to bring those therapies into the lab, to test them in the lab, and then ultimately to develop clinical trials with the goal of really developing combination therapies that'll work well for most, if not all, patients. And that's really a major goal for us in the coming years. So I'll give it back to Brian.
Excellent. Thanks, Andy. So what we tried to do was give you a bit of two examples of how you go from science to the clinic. In the first example, again, you had teams of scientists in the Hale Center. It turned out two teams actually working separately on separate projects, but who were talking often, realized they converged on a similar theme, which is this cell state, TGF-beta, and then designing the clinical trial to attack that. So science in the Hale Center, then we go out and recruit other centers like our friends at MD Anderson, our contacts at some of the biotechnology companies, and then we design the trial, which is what Kim talked with you about. The second part about the KRAS inhibitors that Andy talked about is another kind of model where there are biotechnology companies designing new drugs, but they don't have all the resources, the models, the expertise to do all the testing. So in that case, we partner with them. We help do the testing in the Hale Center, and then we help run the clinical trial as that moves forward. So again, another model of how this is done, really trying to move as rapidly as we can science forward to patients. And I do hope you get a sense of the urgency we feel to really make a difference in the near term for our patients. So I think what we'll do now is we'll open this up to the panel discussion. I'm going to stop sharing my screen so we can see each other. Please, again, put comments and questions in the chat, and I'm going to take them and use them to ask some questions to Kim and Andy, and maybe I'll even put myself on the spot and answer one or two too. But to start with, maybe what I'll do is I see some comments asking, well, we talked about the science, you know, those projects that Andy described and the projects that Kim described in Stephanie's lab, you know, those were multi-year, 3-4 year efforts. But how long does it take to open a clinical trial? And maybe I'll put this to Kim. You know, what are the steps, or in a rough sense, and what's the time frame, maybe using your TGF beta trial as an example?
I can answer that. So it's, I think a lot of it is just the great communication that we have between our clinicians and the members of the lab team. So for example, with this concept, it was presented back in the spring. We started formulating ideas about developing a clinical trial. what that requires is I worked with my colleague, Dr. Singh, and we drafted a protocol, presented it, reviewed it with all the members of the team that I showed you on that slide. A lot of back and forth, just making sure that this was something that we could all support and was asking all the right questions. And then once we got support from everybody, it just goes through the mechanism that Dana-Farber has, which is not unique, but other institutions have as well. It's called an institutional review board, just to make sure that it's has the patients in mind in regards to safety. And also we had to submit to the FDA and get approval that we could use this TGF-beta drug in the protocol. Again, a lot of safety measures are in place to make sure that although we're asking these questions, that they're going to, it, once we get it active, that patients who participate will be safe and will be able to answer the questions that we're looking to answer. And so it's just been going on, and a lot of it ends up being kind of back and forth, lots of emails, lots of meetings, and we are very close. We just have kind of the last minute touches, and we are hoping that in the next 4 to 6 weeks, we'll be able to activate and I'll be able to present this as an option to a patient, you know, before the new year.
Excellent. Thank you, Kim. And I definitely would highlight what Kim said too, that it's the constant communication between the scientists and the clinicians that allow things to move quickly and to design the trial in the right way, right? There's lots of ways these can be done. We want to do this in the smartest possible way to get this therapy to patients and learn, you know, how well these new approaches will work. Andy, maybe I'll pose one to you. There's a question in the chat. It's about collaboration. And you had mentioned, you know, collaborating with other centers. I think that idea came up multiple times. Can you describe that a little bit more? How do you collaborate with other cancer centers, and how do you think about that a bit from a scientific perspective?
Sure, thanks, Brian, and thanks for this question. I think the issue of collaboration is really central to the way we think about cancer research and clinical trial development, certainly in the Hale Center, but I think amongst cancer centers nationally and across the world, we all realize pancreatic cancer is a huge problem that none of us is going to solve on our own. And working together is the way to make progress most quickly and ultimately benefit the most patients in the shortest period of time. And so we collaborate extensively within the Hale Center at Dana-Farber, and we have, you know, a great group of investigators that Brian highlighted earlier with a range of expertise and a very multidisciplinary group of faculty that complements each other very well. And so while any one individual may be able to do something on their own, it might take three times as long than it would to collaborate with a colleague who has a particular expertise and can accelerate that work. And so just about every project we do in the Hale Center is highly collaborative with contributors from multiple different groups. And so it's central to how we think about pancreatic cancer research. And I'd say that in the last decade or so, it's really become central to how other centers think about research as well. And so we've paired with many like-minded colleagues across the country and across the world to develop consortia or groups of labs working on common themes. And for instance, targeting KRAS, there's a group of us at Dana-Farber and Memorial Sloan Kettering and MD Anderson and Johns Hopkins and MIT that have banded together to say, let's try to tackle this problem together. Let's have people in our different groups working together, sharing data early and often, and making rapid progress and starting clinical trials across these centers together so that if a patient's being seen at Memorial, they're accessing not only the best science and best trials at Memorial, but also those at these other centers. And similarly with targeting the immune microenvironment in pancreatic cancer or targeting other cell types in pancreatic cancer, there are many examples of this interinstitutional collaboration. And I guess I'd say I'd take it one step further, not just in the academic setting, but with industry partners and external partners. That's become a fundamental part of how we do science now, is to work with industry partners who have outstanding scientists and brilliant research groups themselves have outstanding chemists who develop new compounds, and we have resources and patient-derived models and animal models to test those therapies, help them design the optimal clinical trial to benefit patients. And so I think there's a lot of like-mindedness across both academia and industry to make a maximal impact as quickly as possible.
Yeah, great. Thank you, Andy. Yeah, I would really highlight that, you know, I think what makes the Hale Center unique is how interconnected and collaborative it is, but that is by no means the full extent of the collaboration that we do. And we really do work a lot with other major centers studying this disease. As Andy knows, and Kim's probably thinking too, even in the past just few days, we've had a conference call with a group at Memorial Sloan Kettering, a conference call with a group at MD Anderson, you know, comparing notes. What are you doing? Here's what we're doing. How do we work together and do this well? And that really, I think, because of the size of this challenge, this is a challenging disease. We really all do want to work together and fix this problem. And so collaboration really does become a major aspect. And then I think, as Andy noted too, you know, some of the, in particular, the chemistry and the compound development is happening in the biopharmaceutical industry or biotech. And we really want to be interacting with the latest work in that space too, including some of the work that Andy showed that's actually from his lab using the latest compounds that are coming out of biotech. Again, we want to do whatever we can to move things to patients quickly and effectively. All right, I'll take another one from the chat. So this one, Andy, I'll pose back to you, goes back to KRAS. And so it's a question around, there are different KRAS mutations. The data you showed were for G12C mutations in KRAS. How common is that? And are there other mutations that are more common? And are drugs coming to inhibit those too? So a little bit of the, what's the landscape that we expect in the next year or two to inhibit KRAS?
Yeah, this is an excellent question. So we mentioned data from one clinical trial of a rare type of KRAS mutation, a codon G12C mutation. And that happens in about 1% of pancreatic cancer patients. So when we find it, we try to target it, get a patient on a particular trial. There are a couple of drugs that are in clinical trials. One of the drugs is approved in lung cancer, not yet approved in pancreatic cancer, but actively being investigated in pancreatic cancer. And so there's great reason for optimism. In fact, Kim Perez is going to lead a trial of one of these KRAS G12C inhibitors in pancreatic cancer patients. Specifically in pancreatic cancer patients, it's going to be a multi-center trial that will be opened at MD Anderson and Memorial and Dana-Farber and Johns Hopkins. And it's going to get patients from each of those centers, study it because it's a rare mutation, study patients together, get biopsies and understand who will respond or not respond. But where does that leave the rest of pancreatic cancer patients, the, you know, the bulk of patients who don't have a KRAS G12C mutation? The most common mutation in pancreatic cancer is a mutation called G12D, a KRAS G12D mutation. It happens in about 35 or 40% of pancreatic cancer patients. And for a long time, that's been a very challenging target. The G12C mutation has a particular feature that made it amenable to developing drugs that bind irreversibly, bind and don't come off. And that was a total revolution in targeting RAS. But recently, there have been some amazing breakthroughs. There are drugs that now specifically target the G12D mutation in KRAS. And those drugs are in very early phase clinical trials. In fact, there's one that's going to be opening Dana-Farber in the phase one setting very soon. There's two additional trials. There's at least three drugs that are coming to early phase trials in within the next year that will be opening at Dana-Farber. They'll be opened nationally that specifically target this KRAS G12D mutation. And similarly, there's enormous effort on the chemistry side to target KRAS G12R and G12V and all RAS mutations. For instance, Dr. Wolpin's opening is currently the principal investigator here of a trial that's targeting not just any one particular mutant form of RAS, but all types of RAS, and seeing if that's just not only tolerable, but can have important efficacy across all RAS mutations. So We're extremely optimistic about the future of targeting RAS. These drugs, in our opinion, can't come quickly enough and can't be rolled out to patients soon enough, but we need to do it in a way that we understand the safety and the efficacy and how to use these drugs to get them ultimately approved and so that they can benefit the most patients.
Thanks, Andy. So I would fully agree. I think the next year is I think an exciting time for these inhibitors coming to the clinic. And we're all excited to see for our patients whether they can be effective. And we would really like to see this now expand beyond KRAS G12C to some of these other mutations, as Andy is describing, while we still learn from those patients who have G12C mutations with the drugs that are available, you know, today. So let me see. It looks like there's a couple questions around early detection, which we didn't focus quite as much on today, but is a big area of focus in the Hale Center. Maybe I'll give sort of a brief overview of how we are approaching this problem in pancreatic cancer. So, you know, at the beginning when we started in the overview slide, we saw that unfortunately most patients still with this disease present with more advanced disease, that it's very hard to rely on just symptoms or findings to find it early, because most patients don't have a lot of symptoms very early, and there's nothing really for a doctor to feel. The pancreas is very deep in the abdomen. It's not like you could feel, say, a lump in the breast or do a colonoscopy and see something easily. It's very hidden and deep in the abdomen and hard to see. So really what we have done in the area of early detection is focused on three main areas. And I'll say one of these areas actually Kim also does in the clinic. The first area is, how do you understand who's at risk? Right. So, you know, for pancreas cancer, although it's difficult to treat, it's not as common as some of the most common cancers like breast cancer or prostate cancer. And so it's very hard to think there'll be a test we would do for every single person in the country, like you do, say, a mammogram for looking for breast cancer. And so really what we ought to understand is, among all these people who are in primary care clinics and seeing their doctors, which are the ones that are at risk for pancreas cancer, who we should have that on our radar and do some surveillance or screening for. And I would say there has been an area where there's been, I think, really major advances in this space, and that has been in those people who have familial risk. So because they have a strong family history or they inherit a genetic mutation. And Kim, in her many roles, right, has many roles, but one of them also is that she sees patients in our genetic risk clinic. So sees patients who have a family history or a genetic mutation related to pancreas cancer. And she actually maps out surveillance plans for these individuals, people who don't have cancer, but we want to make sure if they do get it, we find it early. And there really has been a lot of work in this area. And a lot of the things we do now in the Hale Center is expanding on that in the family risk setting, but also trying to understand, how do we capture more people, right? Family risk is probably 10 to 15%, but that leaves a lot of people who don't have a family risk of pancreas cancer. How do we understand their risk? And I would say some of the major breakthroughs there have been advances in machine learning and artificial intelligence. This is, again, another area where we work with our friends at MIT to help us think this through. And another time we can sort of go through in more detail. That's one big space. The second is blood tests. And I saw there was a question in the chat about that. So if you can find people at risk, what you would like to be able to do is have some non-invasive way to then say, we need to pay attention to this person in particular because there's something in their blood that's telling us that a cancer may be developing. And we have a lot of work in this area. And this has actually also become a very important topic for the biotechnology field in general, right? That there are now a host of biotech companies that are also working in this space, several of which we also work with. We do our own work here. And then again, we're always looking for the latest and the greatest to collaborate with to make sure we help shape, you know, how that stuff is going to come to clinic. So that's the second, risk, blood test. And then we have a big effort in imaging, right? How do we make scans better? It's actually quite hard to find small pancreas tumors on scans as they are today. We want to enhance our ability to see them on scans. And so we have a radiologist. Michael Rosenthal is one of the faces in the circle boxes that you saw, in one of the early slides. He is a radiologist, and it turns out has also a degree in computer science, a PhD. And so we're really working, how do you harness more information from scans? There's so much there we're not using, right? That's on the scan, but it's not being used by the clinical radiologist. Again, how do we bring machine learning into that aspect? So another time we can talk about this in more detail, because I see we're about at the 6 o'clock hour, but we have a very structured way that we're taking on this issue of early detection. And then I would say the final piece to that is what Kim presented in the clinical trial, which is if you find it early, cure it, right? Treat it well, don't let it come back. And so these trials that we run are focused on that. How, if we find a little tumor through these screening mechanisms, how do we make sure we get rid of it and cure the patient so the cancer does not come back to bother them? And that really is the final piece you need to do, right? If you're going to find it early, you ultimately need to cure it. And that's why these treatment trials are also so important. All right, so I see we're at 6:02. I think Kim, Andy, and I would love to spend more time, and we could talk for hours, and you might get bored of all that we had to say, but we really do love talking about these things. There is so much work going on in pancreatic cancer at Dana-Farber, in the Hale Center, and as we talked about with our collaborators too, beyond. And we will hopefully have more time to do that, to discuss this more with you. Yeah, I would just finish with a few things. One is to thank Kim and Andy for joining us tonight. They really are two of the really amazing faculty at Dana-Farber and in the Hale Center. And their work really is pushing the field forward, right? It's them and it's their groups that are making the difference here. So I thank them greatly for spending some time with us tonight. Second, I really do have a tremendous amount of gratitude for Judy Hale, who kicked us off tonight, and for Rob and Karen Hale. A tremendous thank you to them for their support of us and of the work here. Really, we couldn't do it without their partnership. And really, they have also express to us how urgent this problem is, and we know it, and we're working our absolute hardest. And then I would really like to thank everyone who joined us. There are a lot of people in the audience tonight who have supported us in many ways, raising awareness of the disease, riding the PMC, doing the Jimmy Fund walk, providing support to us in terms of helping us understand how patients see things and what they think are the important aspects for us to address. This really is a team effort. And so I really do thank you all for joining us and for all the support that everyone on this call tonight, and hopefully others who will watch it in the future, have provided to us. So we're going to finish there. I just will mention, as the final slide goes up, that I think folks know that Dana-Farber is in the middle of a campaign to support research here at Dana-Farber, and also our clinical care. If you're interested in contributing to that effort, you see how to do that here on the screen. We'll also have a survey for you to fill out, if you don't mind, to help us understand, are we, covering topics and information that are of interest to you? Are the things we didn't touch on that you would be interested in hearing about? I will certainly be interested and excited to come back and have at some point us talk more about early detection and prevention. That's really, again, a key aspect to us. And again, thank you to everyone for joining us. We hope you all have a wonderful evening, and thank you for all of your support.